Let's continue. Finally, Luscinda came out for the ceremony, and again, her beauty was spectacular. Cardenio reports that among all the crimson and white glow of the jewels of her gown and her headdress, the unique beauty of her lovely blonde hair seemed to be in competition with the gemstones and the beams of the four torches that lit up the room. Now Cardenio again interrupts himself to apologize to his listeners for his digressions. The priest forgives him, and he proceeds. The parish priest took Luscinda and Fernando by the hand and voiced the most solemn question of the ceremony. Do you, Lady Luscinda, take Don Fernando, here present, as your lawful husband, as decreed by the Holy Mother Church? Cardenio stuck his head and neck out from the tapestries in order to hear, and he makes yet another digression to tell us that at the time he should have revealed himself and proclaimed, "Ah, traitor Don Fernando, thief of my glory, death of my life, what do you want? What do you seek? Know that you cannot obtain the object of your desires in a Christian manner because Luscinda is my wife and I am her husband." Wait a minute. Does Cardenio have the right to believe himself already married to Luscinda? But instead of interrupting and challenging the validity of the ceremony, Cardenio waited for Luscinda's response. When I thought she would draw out the dagger to prove her sincerity or untie her tongue to utter some truth or rebuke that would redound to my advantage, I hear her saying with a voice faint and thin, "Yes, I do." And Don Fernando said the same, and giving her the ring, they were joined in an indissoluble knot. Luscinda passed out, and upon unbuttoning her bodice to give her air, a letter was discovered, which Fernando took to read by the light of one of the torches. And having read it, he sat down in a chair and put his hand on his cheek, giving indications of a man lost in thought. Thus ends the wedding ceremony, and Cardenio, burning with rage and jealousy, took advantage of the chaos that broke out in the household to escape. He traveled on his mule into the harshest part of the Sierra Morena, fleeing the city like another Lot, not daring to look back at her. All the way, he debated with himself whether to consider Luscinda a traitor or a victim of circumstance. In the end, he attributed her betrayal to Fernando's wealth. Eventually, his mule died of hunger and exhaustion while Cardenio found himself cared for by some goat herds. He understands that he sometimes loses his mind and wanders through the hills, repeating in vain the name of my beloved enemy. All this should remind us of a certain mad Hidalgo who disappeared a few days ago. Cardenio also knows that he commits 1,000 insanities and admits that when he comes to, he is tired and thrashed. Cansado y molido. Goat herds and cattlemen, moved by charity, bring him food, and he, even though he lacks sanity, follows his natural need and eats what they leave him. But these same goat herds have told him that sometimes he comes out onto the roads to rob them of their food by force. On the one hand, Cardenio is a literary and philosophical archetype, a man returned to his natural state, who acts according to his survival instincts. On the other hand, he is clearly sick, but he says there is no cure and he doesn't want any prescribed medicine because if he can't have Luscinda, he doesn't want health. He finishes his story, and just as the priest is about to comfort him, another voice is heard and the chapter ends. Let's review. What an incredible love story Cardenio tells. Jealousy as always, and with the requisite doses of mules and horses, insanities and delusions, letters and money. In spite of details that explain a range of motives and reveal how some characters have manipulated others, I am personally left feeling that things are not what they seem. It is worthwhile to go over Cardenio's story like a detective with a magnifying glass, as if it were a mystery. At the very least, we have to admit that the tone of the novel has changed radically. Powerful melodramatic tension now drives the text, and note how far we have strayed from Don Quixote's original story. Sancho is equally absent. Where is the inventor of the modern novel leading us? Here's a hint. What's up with all these torches, hachas? Obviously, they are light fixtures, but it's worth remembering that the same word means axe in Spanish, and that the double axe is an ancient symbol for the labyrinth.